all to Jesus, I surrender. All to Him, I freely give. Thank you so much for giving, for sharing. I almost feel when you hear music like this, you should not speak anymore. You should just let it sink even deeper. That the notes hit somewhere deeper. It's a beautiful song, isn't it? It's one of the songs I remember from my youth days in the Netherlands. Sitting around campfires and some guitars would come out. And then we would sing songs like these. Yes, they did not sound the same way. Definitely not. But the words were the same. The message was the same. It's about surrendering. Oh, how we do not love to surrender. I hate surrendering. Especially when my wife looks at me for a long time and expects from me a sorry, an apology. And I know I have to surrender sooner or later, but better sooner. It's just not easy, is it? Surrendering. Surrendering to God. A God who is almighty, all-knowing, all-present. Wherever we go, we don't even need really a sat-nav. He's with us everywhere. Wherever we go, He is there. Now, as I grew up, there was a thing that was often said on Saturday morning from downstairs in my household. And it was often my father calling upstairs, "Geert, time," meaning like we were about to leave. And if I did not come down fast, they would be gone. "Time to go to God's house, Geert. Let's go." Going to God's house. I don't know if you've ever yourself used that term or heard that term, going to God's house. I mean, I think it was in the 70s or early 80s, but I think it was the 70s, or maybe even earlier than that, there was it Edwin Hawkins who had this song, "Come and go with me to my father's house, to my father's house." My father had that album, and I remember as a young boy lying under a cupboard. I mean, the cupboard was sort of mounted on the wall, but under it, it was open. And in that cupboard, there were drawers, and my father made it himself as being a carpenter, and one of those drawers, he had a built-in turntable on which you would have these big plastic circular things that you put on there, and it gave you music. We called them records. And I would listen to that album a lot because the other song on there was "Oh Happy Day." And it would just lift me up. But especially that song, "Go and come with me to my father's house, to my father's house." Going to God's house. Now a sister, an older sister, was sitting with a younger brother in church. It was Sunday morning and the boy was not able to sit still or to be quiet. So finally the older sister said, "I wish you would just sit down and be calm." To which the younger brother said, "I can't. It's just so boring." To which the older sister turned to him and said, "It's supposed to be boring." Alex, another boy, would every Sunday morning go to church. And in their church, they had in the hall, when you would come in, there was this huge plaque with all kind of names, and there were flags around it, flags from that country. Now, the boy was 7 years old. Alex was 7 years old. And he had been now looking on this Sunday morning to that plaque on the wall for quite a while as Pastor McGee came in. And the pastor looked at the boy and said, "Good morning, Alex. "Good morning, Pastor," replied the young boy, but kept on looking on the plaque on the wall. "Pastor, what is this? What is this?" "Well, son, it's a memorial to all of the young men and women who died in the service." Alex kept on looking at the plaque, and you could see that all now a tear was coming down his eye, and his lips were starting to shake. He was ready to really start crying, and then he asked a question to the pastor. "Pastor, which service do people die? Is it 10 o'clock or the 11 o'clock? I mean, I've seen things happen during our worship times. I remember when I was younger that in the small church where I grew up with, which we were renting, in the summertime, I mean, the organ was up in the loft. And the organ player could look on a mirror and could see then over his shoulder, he could see what was happening downstairs, so he knew when to start playing. Now, it was a very hot summer, and I remember that as he came down from his organ and we were going into the rest of the worship, as he was walking down his seat, all of a sudden you would hear, "Ah," and he collapsed. He collapsed right in the middle. I remember that still so vividly because that had never happened. But someone collapsed and he was in a bad shape. We as young children, I mean, I was about 8 or 9 years old, we thought he had died. And I was reminded of that moment when I was reading this funny story. Pastor, do people die in this service? My parents, they had their hands full with me. I've already mentioned it a couple of times. I was also one of those boys not sitting still. And I know that my father many times told me, "Geert, you have to behave here. This is God's house." What are you thinking of when you come into a place like this? What does it mean to you when you hear these words, "Welcome to God's house"? Last week, as I was sharing a thought with worshipers in the parallel, I called it growing pains. Growing pains. And today is actually sort of like part two of growing pains. That's why I call it more growing pains. Because we know when you grow up, it's sometimes painful, isn't it? Yeah, as a young boy, I remember that I would have these shooting pains in my legs and my arms that would wake me up. And my mother would then calm me down and say, "Like, son, they're just shooting pains. You're just growing up. Don't worry." Now, last week, we looked at chapter 6 of Acts. And we see that here is this young group of believers. They're just starting off, and very soon, it's only a few months into their sort of moving together, experiencing together, sharing together, there's already disagreement. That there are different ways of taking care of things. And you would wonder, like, how is it possible that this young group, full of fire, just the Holy Spirit has come into them, and they're already disagreeing with one another? But that happens. As young groups, you grow, and with growth comes pain. Have you ever come into a church place, into a beautiful building? And as you walk through the front doors, you see all of a sudden this arch right above the main entrance into the main hall. And the words written down, "Be reverent, for God is here." Be reverent, for God is in this place. God is here. I wonder what Stephen would have thought of that if he came into a place with these words above a door. You see, when I'm reading chapter 7, and you can disagree with me, that's fine, and we can share some thoughts of how you read the passage, but as I was reading this passage for the last couple of weeks, chapter 7 of Acts, where we see the story of Stephen just starting to really come about and ending in not such a positive way for him. Now, I don't want to split hairs, but I think Stephen would have difficulty with a slogan that would be saying above a door, "Be reverent here, for God is here." I think, in a way, part of his reason to be stoned had to do with this. That he had a different idea about this. Stephen, as you read the chapter, you see him standing in front of the Jewish leaders, the ones who are in charge, the ones who are there for the religious atmosphere, those who put down the rules. This is how we do it. And you do it, or you will be in trouble. Now, Stephen stands in front of this whole group of leaders. And what does he do? He starts speaking. He starts with history lessons. He just goes back in history. First a history lesson, and then he gives a theological application. He gives a theological class to these Jewish leaders. What should have been very clear to these leaders, having studied so much in God's Word, knowing most of it by heart, and of course at that time that was the Old Testament, but even try that to learn by heart, just the Old Testament. Yeah, good luck. But they knew it. They knew what the Word said. They had been studying it as a little boy the moment they could read. He's standing in front of them, and he's trying to teach them. Trying to teach them that God's way are not our ways, and often our ways are not God's ways. That God has a new way of sharing, of speaking. And this new way, this religious group, these teachers, these Jewish leaders, as they were listening to Peter preaching, they got more and more and more uncomfortable. And from becoming uncomfortable, became angry. And from angry, they would eventually become murderous. Now, it's a great passage to read for yourself. But it's so easy to say, like, yes, Pastor, but that happened 2,000 years ago, give and take. We are now here in 2017. It is only about 10 to 8 on the clock. So, good morning, you're very early here. I'm impressed. But you know what? Stephen is still speaking today. They might have tried to silence him, but he's still speaking. He's still saying a couple of things which I think are important for us. First of all, he's taking the Jewish leaders and us back on memory lane. What he's saying, let's go back. Let's look at our history. Let me remind you of something. Now, if you've looked at the passage, if you've looked at the chapter 7, don't be alarmed. I'm not going from chapter 7, verse 1, all the way to the end. Don't worry. But please, if you have a Bible with you, keep it open to that chapter, chapter 7 of Acts. Stephen is going on memory lane. I mean, of course, the Jewish leaders, they believe that God is there. They believe in God's omnipresence, that he is everywhere. But as they were teaching, and as they were experiencing it themselves, that was a whole different ballgame. God was not that omnipresent. To get to God, to experience God, to be with God, to get to know God, you had to come to the temple, because that's where God was. Always was and always will be to them. So if you wanted to have an experience with him, you had to come to them and through them to meet this God. And so for them, this was a moment of growing pains. Although they were adult men, this was going to be painful. And we have that saying, don't we? No pain, no gain. It's often through pain that we do learn. And in faith, there's nothing different to that. In faith, we also will find for ourselves. I mean, none of us believes the same way as we did when we were 6, 7, 8, 9 years old, or whenever you started to read the story and it became more and more personal to you. I mean, I know for myself, I'm not believing the same way as I did 5 years or 10 years ago, 20 years ago, because I have more experiences. I have different experiences. I get to know different people. They have an influence on me. I have an influence on them. We change each other. That is life. And that's sometimes scary and sometimes painful. But let's look at what Stephen is doing. I mean, you start with the beginning of that chapter. You go to verses 2 to 8. Stephen recalls that God was with Abraham. He starts the history of the people of Israel with Abraham. It says, to this he replied, brothers and fathers, listen to me. He's talking to this group of men. The God of glory appeared to our father Abraham while he was still in Mesopotamia before he lived in Haran. And he goes on talking about this Abraham. Abraham who received the promises from God himself. God who said to Abraham, walk to this lake, walk to this beach, see the sand along the water. Can you count the grains of sand? You can't. And that is how I will bless you with your descendants. You won't be able to count them. Just look tonight at the sky, God would have said to Abraham. Look at the sky and look at the stars. And the more you look, have you noticed that? The more you look, the more stars you see. You keep on looking and looking, and especially if there's no pollution of light, but it's really dark around you. It seems like you can go deeper and more and more. That was God's promise to Abraham. But you know, as God was given these promises to Abraham, Abraham did not have a building where he would go to hear this from God. There was no place for that. God just spoke to Abraham where he was. Now, Stephen does not stay too long with Abraham. He goes to verse 9 and then all the way to 19. And he brings in another hero of faith for the Israelites, Joseph. Because the patriarchs were jealous of Joseph, they sold him as a slave into Egypt. But God was with him, the Bible says. There was no place, no building, but God was with Joseph. God was with Joseph as he was back home with his family, then in slavery, then he went into prison, then later he becomes even the minister of Egypt. But Joseph does not have a building to worship. But it says God was with Joseph. Stephen continues with history lessons, verse 20 to 43. Now here comes one, Moses. Now, if there was anyone that families probably would think like, oh, I wish my son would look like anyone from the Bible like that, that would have been Moses. Moses was just like the man. And you can see that part of the story is longer than any of the others. There's so much to share about Moses. That God was with Moses as he was a young boy, put by his sister there in the river. And then growing up in an Egyptian family place. God was with him in Midian as he's there as a shepherd. And God speaks to him in a bush on Mount Sinai during the Exodus. The journey through the desert, God was with Moses. And they don't have a building to worship in. And it's only at the latter part, later on, that God says, build a tent. Make a tent where we can come together. The tabernacle. And that is where then also some of the ceremonies, some of the regulations of worship will start to be described. But Stephen is not done yet. Verse 44 to 45, those two verses, he says, God was with Joshua as he leads the Israelites into the promised land. Yet they don't have a permanent building. Yes, the tabernacle is there. But as you look at the description and as you look at the reason why the tabernacle was there, it was never supposed to be a place where you would have to come to meet God. You see, the tabernacle was not a place where God was locked into inside and couldn't go anywhere else. He goes on with David, another big hero. He says, the tabernacle, that's what he means. It remained in the land until the time of David, who enjoyed God's favor and asked that he might provide a dwelling place for the God of Jacob. I mean, we know the story of David, don't we? I mean, he had dreamt about building for God this wonderful, massive building in the heart of Jerusalem. He wanted to build this beautiful place. But God says no to David. And I know one of the things I was always told was that God said no to David because David had done so many things wrong. He had blood on his hands. Yes, I know that was one of the reasons why God said no, David. But I also think that God had another thought in his mind. That God thought like, I don't need a place like that. I don't need a specific place where you're going to box me in and keep me inside. Again and again, God is telling David, I'm with you wherever you go, King. I am with you. And finally, as Stephen tells the history lesson to the Jewish leaders, he says, God was with Solomon, as verse 47 said, but it was Solomon who built a house for him. Finally, there is this building of mortar and stone, and all the beauty inside and outside, and all the different people knowing exactly what to do, where to walk, how to behave, what not to do, what to do. Women, you have to stay on the other side of the walls, and pagans, you even have to stay further away from the walls because God is here. This is holy ground. And it's interesting when you read that that building was built, and you look at what happens then from that moment on, when the building is there, the temple is there, it seems like it's going downhill. The whole relationship of the people of Israel with their God is going downhill. I mean, you read through all the prophets, the minor prophets, the bigger prophets, and you hear like all they're saying is, come back to your Lord, have a relationship with your Lord, listen to him, be with him, share your life with him. But all it had become was a ritual inside that building. And Stephen's lesson he was trying to share there through history was, God does not live in buildings made by men. Can you now understand why these Jewish leaders, these men, became upset? While their blood started boiling? Why that is? What do you mean God is not in temples? God is not in our temple. I mean, that is why we are here. You're basically dealing with our identity. You're taking away our life. This is what we live for. And they had a good life from it. Stephen is hurting their income and was hurting the way that they thought things were. Verse 48 to 50. However, as it was read by Joseph, however, the Most High does not live in houses made by human hands. As the prophet says, heaven is my throne and the earth is my footstool. What kind of house will you build for me, says the Lord? Or where will my resting place be? Has not my hand made all these things? In other words, am I not everywhere? Am I not omnipresent? Stephen is saying, I'm not telling you anything new. Dear leaders, dear religious leaders, I'm not telling you anything new. God was never in one place. God was always omnipresent. God was with us everywhere. That's why I went through all these heroes of faith to tell you God was with them, not with a place or a building. And so there is memory lanes, step one. But now Stephen then immediately goes into the spiritual application, the teaching, like, this is just history. These are facts. Let me go deeper. And Stephen tells it as it is. Yeah, the leaders have become annoyed. They start to feel like, where is this going? You might hurt our income. You might hurt the way that people are looking at us. But he had not yet accused them of anything, really. Not yet. But then he goes into the next few lines. And I tell you, if you want to make friends, if you want to build relationships, don't start like this. You stiff-necked people. Your hearts and ears are still uncircumcised. You are just like your ancestors. You always resist the Holy Spirit. Was there ever a prophet your ancestors did not persecute? They even killed those who predicted the coming of the righteous one. And now you have betrayed and murdered him. You who have received the law that was given through angels, but have not obeyed it. How about that one? Ever tried that one in a Sabbath school class? When someone disagrees with you? It's like, oh, you stiff-necked person. Well, we might think it, actually, if we are honest to ourselves. But you know what? This goes a lot deeper, right? I mean, we know. I mean, we are looking with hindsight. We can look back in time, and we can see the story unfolding, but they could not. It hits home. And we know it gave a reaction, and it brought us our first Christian martyr. When the members, verse 52, when the members of the Sanhedrin heard this, they were furious, gnashed their teeth at him, but Stephen, full of the Holy Spirit, looked up to heaven, saw the glory of God, and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. Look, he said, I see heaven open, and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. At this, they covered their ears, and yelling at the top of their voices, they all rushed at him, dragged him out of the city, and began to stone him. Meanwhile, the witnesses laid their coats at the feet of a young man named Saul. While they were stoning him, Stephen prayed, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. And then he fell on his knees, and he cried out, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. He heard that line before, right? Someone else had spoken those words, pretty similar. And when he had said this, he fell asleep. Yes, how the truth hurts. I mean, they had their teeth together. And I mean, you know, sometimes people in their sleep, they can put their teeth sideways and that's a sound that not many people really like to hear. I mean, that's like with your fingers going over a blackboard, like, I mean, you don't even have to hear it. Some people already feel like, Well, it's the same with teeth. But in this case, it's faces with anger and hate, murder in their eyes. They cover their ears and they yell. They don't want to hear anything anymore from this man. And the life of Stephen comes to an end. But our lives continue today. We are here. So what can I take from that to come to the final conclusion? First, Stephen's message, God does not live in man-made buildings. The Most High does not live in houses made by human hands. I remember also when I was about 10 years old, we had to leave that church that I talked about where the organ player came down and collapsed because of the heat. Now, we had to leave that church. We could no longer rent it. And we went to another place, but there were no churches available we could rent. So we started to rent a school. We rented a school to come together. And I heard the stories from my parents that at that time, quite a considerable part of that congregation of about 100 members felt like that was not right. You can't do church in a school. Because we were sitting in a room, and you had all these things from the classes on the wall, and it was distracting, and it was not proper. It was not the right place. And I've heard people sometimes talking about it when people meet in living rooms, church plants, in cafes, even in cinemas, people come together to worship God. And not to watch a movie, don't get me wrong. But actually, when cinemas are being emptied and are being turned into a church for people to meet. And people say, that can't be right. But you know what? The Apostle Paul, and we'll come to that in chapter 19 of Acts, the Apostle Paul actually taught and was part of a church for 2 years in a school. It was called the Lecture Hall of Tyrannus. And so there's nothing new under the sun. None of the New Testament Christian groups that were forming fast and growing in numbers by the thousands did have a church building where they would go to. They came into each other's houses. Acts keeps on saying that. They came in each other's houses, broke the bread, praise God. They didn't have places. They didn't have churches. God doesn't live in buildings. God lives wherever true believers come together. I mean, Jesus tried to say that in Matthew 18. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, there I must be in their midst. Through my years, I've had a lot of privileges of traveling around, going to different countries. And one of the things that I love to do most is when we come in big cities, is to go to these huge cathedrals. I love to step into these buildings, these places of worship. I mean, I've been to the cathedral in Cologne, in Germany. I've seen the Notre Dame in Paris. I mean, we've got our churches here in England, wherever you go. And I love going to these places. But whenever I step inside these buildings, I also realize how dead these places are, because they're just stone and maybe beautiful glass windows, but it's just dead stone. Bless you. They're just dead places, except if people come in and bring in life. A place can look dead even with people sometimes. God is not in the building. If God is not in the hearts of people in that building, then God is not in the building. Jesus said, where those come together in my name and worship me, I am with them. Yes, it's beautiful to have our own places. There are advantages of having our own beautiful places where we can come together. But it's only a place of worship if the people in it have God in their hearts. We could make this place as beautiful as we like, but if we don't bring God with us in our hearts, this place is an empty place. The only way to experience God is not by walking into any kind of a building that says this is God's house. It is by coming in and experiencing God in your heart, in your life. The second thing and last thing I learned from Stephen is that if you are a believer, as you are here, if you are a believer of God, then wherever you are is holy ground. I don't think that Stephen just by coincidence talked about Moses and about that moment where God says, this is holy ground. Take off your sandals, for you are in my presence. You see, holy ground can be our church building. But holy ground should also be at work. Holy ground should be as we are at play, whether we do sports or we have leisure, any hobbies, God should be there. Yes, God was even with Allison as she was in her car, looking where to go. Wherever we are, that will become holy ground. Even when we are at home, that is where it becomes holy ground if God lives within us. Because we have learned and we talk about it that often we say our body is what? It's the temple of the Holy Spirit. Well, by that we actually say God lives in us. We take him with us. See, the problem that Stephen saw and the problem that we so easily can fall into as well if we are not careful is that we want to make our buildings today for the same reason. We come to meet God. That's how I learned it as a young boy. Geert, you're going to God's house. Dress properly, behave properly, do the proper thing. But you know, as that was poured into me, you know what happened? The moment I stepped through those doors, God stayed there. And I could misbehave out there. I could do whatever I liked in a way. Because here God was. And Stephen is saying, no. God was with Abraham, was with Moses, Joseph, all of those people. Even when there was no building, God was with them where they were. As they stood on the ground, that became holy ground. I hope, I pray, that we will not fall in that same trap as the Jewish leaders did. And Stephen was telling them, change. You need to change. Because, yes, God can be here if he's in your heart, but God goes with you when you leave. So don't think that when you go through the doors, don't think when you leave Jerusalem, that you can use bad language, that you can lie, that you can cheat, that you can gossip, that you can lust, that you can hate, that you can worry, that you can fear. Because wherever you go, you are in God's house. Wherever you stand, that is holy ground. May we leave this place and truly believe what Stephen was trying to say, and he gave his life for, is God is with us where we go. While they were stoning him, Stephen prayed, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. Then he fell on his knees and cried out, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. And when he had said this, he fell asleep. I'm looking forward to the day that when we go home, and we're going to see Stephen and others. And Stephen will share with us stories of history. And we will share with him our stories of history. But then in all, we can share that Jesus was living in us wherever we went. May we be truly worshipers God seeks in spirit and in truth. God bless us all. Amen. Now, I know that reality is just around the corner. When we leave this place, we go to our daily routines, the things that happen. But I hope that this message will ring inside of us in some personal way. We all listen differently. We all take things differently. But may we remember to take Jesus with us and to know that, as the song says, with Jesus, there's power. There's power, power, power in the blood. Our Lady, Sister White, gives us an encouragement. The disciples were the channel of communication between Christ and the people. This should be a great encouragement to his disciples today. Christ is the great center, the source of all strength. His disciples are to receive their supplies from him. The most intelligent, the most spiritually minded can bestow only as they receive. Of themselves, they can supply nothing for the needs of the soul. We can impart only that which we receive from Christ. The work of building up the kingdom of Christ will go forward. Though to all appearance it moves slowly, an impossibility seems to testify against advance. The work is of God, and he will furnish means, and will send helpers, true, earnest disciples, whose hands also will be filled with food for the starving multitude. God is not unmindful of those who labor in love to give the word of life to perishing souls. Beautiful words in Desire of Ages, page 370 and 71. We're leaving this place knowing God goes with us, ready to fill our hands and to supply others that are in need. May we leave with his power and his blessing. Dear God, God Father, God Son, God Holy Spirit, thank you for going with us, for filling us with your love,
for receiving your power and to see your mission. May we leave, and may we eventually on that day hear those words, "Come to me, you faithful and true friend." Amen.